goal is to want to encode these terms on quantum bits. So for example, you would have on the x dot x, you would have, you know, the letter lambda tensor the letter x tensor the letter dot tensor the letter x. And then since these are qubits, well, you can have this superposition of lambda terms. And so it seems very fun. You know, they're okay, let's do it. Let's try to better addition of the unitary map. So your unitary map, but you know, you have h try to choose and to go to what the superposition of what it should be. And if you want to do some better addition, why you just do it. And so this would be, you know, like this would be the myth you actually say this would be fun. If you have such a thing, you can also then have some sort of quantum test. You can say, well, you know, I have on each base state, I may have some booleans, and so I may want to do some test on it. So for example, I do h time true, and I do a test on it, and if it's true, I do m, and x I do n, so I reduce. I get some superposition, I rewrite the thing, and I get a first term plus a second term, so these are perfectly valid lambda terms you can reduce, and you get m plus n. So of course this would only work if m and n are orthogonal. But so this is more or less the ambient framework of this talk. So as such, it has been studied by someone called Tonder, and so actually said, okay, let's try such a lambda calculus with a better addition unitary, and let's try to have some sort of thing that a formal system that actually work out nicely and have a nice equational theory. And it turns out that, you know, if you want complete high order and complete unitary of your beta addition, the only possible superposition of the only possible term in superposition are the ones that are equal up to the places where they are true and false. So in other words, you get in fact complete classical lambda calculus with possibly some qubits inserted into it. So it's not a real superposition of lambda. At first order, if you are only interested into first order and you want this quantum test, this quantum if, you can do it. This was done by Jonathan Gratach. He wrote a language called QLR, and there is no unitary beta addition, but there is a compilation into quantum circuits, and it works in order to be able to say something a bit quantum, I add a constant C that will refer to the Adam argate, but you can imagine that you can pick there your preferred unitary gate, you can put several of them if you want. I will stick to this one. That's it, so where there is a typing system that is reasonably standard, it's a strict typing system, so in the context, you have only in the context the free variable of the corresponding term. So, well, if I want to build a lambda abstraction of type A on EC, I need some variable of type A and M of AC. If I want to apply a function, the type should correspond. If I want to build a product of a tensor, well, I need the context of M and N to be disjoint because I'm strictly linear. So this is just linear algebraic calculus. What's interesting is the two rules below. So this thing behaves as a coproduct in the sense that it has an additive behavior. So the context is the same for M and for N, and if the context is the same, then I can construct the sort of the pairing of M and N with some alpha and beta, with some scalars alpha and beta. And this will be of type A plus B, if N is of type A and N of type B. So, in order to be able to use this object, I need a match function. Since I want to be able to really keep things as separated as possible, to keep a possible orthogonality feature, the match function, usually when you have a match function, it's like a test, so you test on something and both branches have the same type. So here I make sure that both branches of the match have different type, so that if I match over some term P of type A plus B, if it so happens that I reach x of type A, then I will produce a name of type C. But if I were to go to the element B of the type B, then I would produce an N of type D. So that this thing is take a map from A tensors A loli C, a map from A B loli D, and return a map from A plus B to C plus D. So there is absolutely no entanglement or intricate entanglement that can occur in this use of the mesh. Like you really have two things that are orthogonal and that stay as orthogonal as possible. So what the reduction rules are, the one that you would expect. I set a goal by value reduction, but the language is strictly linear, so probably doesn't really matter. The match function take one of these funny products. So and so if I return another funny product with where you replace the variable x that occurred in N with the M prime that we have here, and on the other branch of the product, you will replace the Y that occurred in N by M prime. And you keep and you make sure you keep the scalars. So this constant term C is there to be able to change the alpha and beta somehow, and so since I want to interpret this as an Adam argate, the reduction will do a combination of alpha and beta that correspond to the Adam argate. Well, so if you do this somehow, the language verifies the reduction and progress. So there is did do some actual linear, actual algebraic lambda-calculus. So the Lagrangian I'm considering is a system F. So I have a four-order X dot A in the types. It's a regular system F together with the special feature, algebraic feature of the calculus. Namely, I can multiply a term by the scalar. I have a zero term, and I can add terms. Voilà. So there are the usual typing rules for system F. Modulo the fact that we are working in all the value again. And so the typing rules for these three constructors are the following. More or less, you don't change the type. So M plus N is of type A if both things are of type A. And alpha dot N is of type A if N is of type A. And 0 can be of any type. For the reduction rules, there is a complete list, but morally, any reasonable vector space rule applies. So if you have something of that form, if you have beta time a sum, where you can actually you can distribute the scalar multiplication and so on. Also reasonable rule, the system is modulo associativity and commutativity. Finally, we are morally called by values, so the application is linearly distributive on both sides, but the lambda abstraction is not. So the lambda abstraction acts as the module. Great! So I want to embed my nice language board into this. So in system F, there is a canonical way of representing coproduct, product, tensor, and so on. So we sort of follow the ID and translate the row into the usual row. Digo product and tensor and unit of the tensor into some particular rule, into some particular type of the system F. So let's concentrate on the go product. How do I, if I want to encode the product of alpha M and beta N, how do we do that? Well, I produce a term lambda F dot lambda G. So this term takes a function F of type A around X and a function G of type B around X. And it produces the superposition of F applied to M. M is of type A, so this is fine. And G applied to M, which is of type B, so this is fine. And I sum them with alpha and beta, and since the lambda abstraction is a closure, this is a sound term, it's a value. Once you have defined your product like that, the match function just follows, and the language is nice enough so that you can, and the interpretation is nice enough so that you can interpret the constant term C in the way so that it actually corresponds to the application of an Adamard point. So small results, I effectively have the fact that if M reduces to N, then the interpretation of N reduces to the interpretation of N. More or less the types are preserved. Am I effectively able to have non-trivial superposition of terms? Yes, I am. Here is an example of term in the language port. So alpha y beta lambda x applied to something. If I translate this into a lambda line, I get a non-trivial superposition of stuff. And this bar is actually the thing that was there. So this is effectively a non-trivial superposition of term. I'm happy. The first part of the program is covered. So now I said, well, this is very nice. I claim that my language ORT is orthogonality aware. So let's compile ORT into quantum circuits. So interpreting first order language was done in QML. So we can use this work for our language ORT. The main difficulty, of course, is for the lambda abstraction that was not done, so we have to do something for that. So we use a trick that was proposed by Pascal in 1999, and the idea is the following: if you are in a nice enough setting, for example, all your material quantum circuit that is built upon a given set of gates, it is possible to write a gate epsilon that will take a representation of your quantum circuit, an element on which you are supposed to act, and epsilon will run the computation u and produce u of x on the other side. So the gate epsilon interpret the program u. And so if we are able to do that, there is a good hope that we can actually encode ORT into quantum circuits. So at first we are not considering a full-fledged program. We are just considering one instruction. So we consider an alphabet where we have symbols for each gate u that we are concerned with. Natural numbers, tuples of natural numbers, boolean true and false. We will have an assembly language consisting of instructions before u, where u is a gate in the set of gates we are interested in, and tuples of number. So this tuples of number will be the numbering of the wire on which u is supposed to act. Great. And so now I can write an emulator step epsilon l as a unitary gate of the space of some space based on H, where H is the Hilbert space generated by the alphabet. So what is doing this epsilon l? If the input is of the form of a valid instruction and an input, then it will actually do what it is supposed to do on the input, and just not change the input, the instruction. Otherwise, it will just act as the identity on the input. So this thing is reversible. Therefore, it is supposed we should be able to encode it as a unitary. Now, if we happen to have a set of gates closed under controlled operation, then a gate epsilon L is itself encodable as can itself be written in the assembly language of these instructions. So of course, it will be a bigger program than it was originally. But therefore, we can simulate an epsilon step with another epsilon step. And so that way, we are able to actually do something that looks like higher order. Right. So let's look at a simple example. Here is an epsilon 2, an emulator on two qubit input for the alphabet consisting of some gates H and M. So how to read this? So remember, here I don't. This wire is not just a qubit. It is some vector space whose base state can be true, false, H, N, where I find the input of the instruction I'm reading. So the instruction consists of a gate that can be H or N, and a tuple of number, in this case only one. This is to be read as a control operation where I only do something if I read an H and a 1 here. And what I do a gate H. So here, if I place as input H1 and then something here, this code will actually apply H on this waveform. Okay, so now we are good to go. Let's try to have wrote this orthogonal lambda-calculus to compile this orthogonal lambda-calculus using this. So the lambda-calculus is relatively simple in the sense that it is strictly linear. So every variable, the variables are not duplicated, they are more or less used only once, so everything is relatively fine. And so what we have to do is to keep track of where to put what we are supposed to attach the wires, the various wires of our input circuit. So for that, we're going to index the types. So we will have sorted. So for simplicity, we will have sorted wires. Wires that are Boolean, program or unit. And so, to each type, we will assign a list of wires as follows. So, to the type top, we attach a wire that we can call number 1. It will be a sort unit. If I have two types A, if I have a tensor, this could be a B, but I just put a numbering on the first A and another numbering on the second A, and this numbering has to be distinct. If I have a sum, I do the same thing, except that I also add a number on the symbol plus, and this new number will be a sort Boolean. And now, if I have a loli, again I do the same thing, but this time the number attached to the loli will be a sort program. Again, for simplicity, we are restricted to the case where we have co-product of the form A plus A. And so finally, we will have open wires and closed wires. The closed wire will be the one that has a value given. Yes? Ah, okay. So let's see how we can construct index linear regression and quantum circuits. So the axiom the axiom rules are relatively simple. This is a naked wire called 1. This is a naked wire called 1. It's a wire of type top, so it will be it will be morally a complex number, so we can as well not put a wire, I guess. And so this one is interesting. This one, there is a type for the loli, a type for the plus. It is supposed to be the same type here, and then I have type for I, but again I is not very interesting. So what is the corresponding circuit? I create a wire number 3 to which I put the instruction to apply the damper gate on the wire number 2, which has nothing, which is doing nothing. So it's a rather simple circuit. What about the lambda abstraction? So upstairs, eventually I arrive to some term M, and I have a nice quantum circuit. Well, I just take this quantum circuit, rewrite it as a set of instructions, and create a wire number 4 to which I give the value. quantum circuit, a term L that will have produced some quantum circuits. I can plug them together next to each other because thanks to the linearity of the thing and the way you index index types, they should not step on each other's foot. So if L happen to have set some value on 4, N will not have put some value on the same number 4. So it should be good. And so, well, we actually want to do the application, so we will plug after an application that will read the wire number 5. The wire number 5 corresponds to the should correspond to the description of the program that M is producing. What about this famous product that is supposed to represent the superposition? Well, here we have so we have the same gamma, the same context for L and for N. So we will these two types are the same. We will index the indexing. The indexing is the following. So all the numbers corresponding to tau on both sides will be the same. For plus, they will be the same when possible, and they will be completely distinct on the ring. And then, well, we create a qubit on the wire number 3 that is supposed to be the one created specially for this plus, and then we do a control operation for M, a control operation for N, and if for N, you do some possible crossing of wires to keep track of reading. Well, and so you can do, and then there is again the rule for match, and so the result is the following. We do have M and N. Both interpretation of M and N are equal if M is reduced to N. So it works because everything is static and the language is rather simple. And then I have a virtual example. A last result, I can simulate a quantum circuit providing that I'm only using H and controlled H. I can encode a quantum circuit in orthogonal or lambda-calculus, and if I go back to the quantum circuit, I get broadly the same unitary, so you know, sort of sound. I guess I'm done, and I managed to fulfill the requirement at the beginning of the talk.
Any question? Can you show the previous slide again, please?
Which previous slide?
Oh, not this one. No, 34.
34?
Yes. 30.
34.
Yes. Okay, well, I don't know if I missed something, but what is kbk plus 1 and why is it equal to kbk plus?
This?
Yeah.
It said on this slide that I skipped. So you would expect that the qubit is written like that because this is supposed to contain the qubit. So one qubit is represented by this type. This is 5. Now you could say, okay, well, qubit tons of qubits could be that this is reasonable. But in fact, if you look at what you can do in the orthogonal and calculus, you cannot entangle qubits if they are of that type. For qubits to be entangled, you need to represent two qubits using this type. So again, you have 1 plus there, that is the qubit number 2, and inside there is the qubit number 1, which is here. And this one can be entangled. And there is a map from this one to this one. Right. So this is why just because I gave the language with the gate H.
But you could have any sort of setup.
Ah, of course, if originally I had some other set of gates.
Because this one is not universal.
Ah, no. No, it's just because I said originally that I have only H. But of course, if I have H on all the gates, then I can do them the same way.
Okay, let's move to the next.